Okay, start recording. Okay, today our discussion is about the domain-driven design, and Lina would like to present to me what are the questions or things that she has. Okay. Okay, you can start presenting. You are on air now.
Okay. First of all, I read about unit of work. I think this is the low level in data layer, data access layer. So to persist a data in a database, we need to manipulate data in the transactions. So the unit of work is the transaction that we need the comment to succeed all to fail all.
Yeah.
So we need to gathering all the commands that we need to execute at once in a one unit of work. For example, maybe for order, we need the order header with order lines, with its lines. We can't, in some cases, save order, and we miss to save lines because of interruption or connection problem or whatever. So we should look at this problem as a one unit, and we need to complete it at in this in one time. So my suggestion in our database design, most of tables it is about header and lines and extensions and sometimes events. So the general case, we have four tables from database point of view, but maybe from business point of view, we have one thing to do. For example, for create catalog, from business point of view, it is one thing, that is catalog creation. But from database level or database point of view, we need to create a catalog header with its lines, with sometimes with extensions. And I think in all time, we need to save events, catalog events. We need to, in every time, to save maybe catalog creation in time, in a specific time and a specific status and whatever. So these four tables would be aggregated in a design pattern which called aggregate or aggregate container. This aggregate should contain four tables, header, extensions, lines, and events with some rules. Also, the aggregate design button, it contains components with rules that we should respect when composing these components. For example, when we need to create catalog, we need to ensure that the catalog header GUID is exist in all its lines. We need to ensure maybe some rules we can define when we define the business need. We can define what is the set of rules. So we need to have these four tables aggregated in aggregate design button, which is components and related rules. So the unit of work will handle this aggregate container whole as one thing. The unit of work will start with the begin transaction, then whatever we do with the DAO object on these tables, then at last we need to commit a transaction. I noticed in core one design, the begin transaction and commit transaction wasn't in unit of work. This begin transaction and commit transaction is placed in a higher level, in domain level.
Not fully correct. I agree with you, and sometimes it is possible that when an API call is made, part of the certain things go through successfully unit of work.
Mm.
Maybe it is okay for certain part to be failed. It is okay. Let's say, for example, I want to create a sales order, and more importantly, is the sales order is created successfully. Maybe the email or the membership point has creation is has failed, but yeah. That part is not critical. I can recreate it again later if I detect it or I have a way to detect it, right?
Yeah. In this case, we don't have one unit of work. The order is one unit of work. The sending email is another unit of work. I think in this case, these are different. And we shouldn't consider these one transaction. We need to make unit of work smaller as possible, because it is specific to one transaction only. The transaction from business point of view is one thing, only generate invoice, only create catalog, only one thing. But from data layer point of view, it may be a lot of operations or maybe some of comments that we need to handle data of 5 or 6 tables or whatever. So we need to break down our business or our problem into smaller pieces. Each small piece is the responsibility of one unit of work. So I think begin transaction and committing a transaction in domain level, this transaction, it is not really, I think domain level should not know about transaction or about low level action, how it will done. So to follow unit of work design pattern, how it should work, we need to each unit of work make it small as possible and commit it as one thing. In a higher level, in domain level, in most cases we need many of unit of work. To complete one scenario. Maybe we need to generate invoice, then send email. Maybe we need to send SMS as notification, and some other steps. These steps, all of them, one scenario, but it is multiple use cases. Let's say use cases. This unit of work will handle the aggregator or the aggregate container, which contain the components and rules that should apply on the components to make sure all the components are consistent with each other. This the low level data layer, data access layer, unit of work will handle aggregator. In the upper level, we need a repository. The repository design button need to communicate with domain layer just for sending maybe messages and receive messages, or let's say for make query about something from the repository layer. The repository layer will return back to domain with the result. But here in from repository to domain layer, we need another type of object to handle. From repository to unit of work, the data type container. And lines. No?
Okay.
Sorry?
From repository to unit of work, it is one layer. So you need to think about whether from repository to unit of work, it should be factory or factory. That means that the abstract factory or something like that. And then just now you were saying that beyond the repository to the this one is to the unit of work, then the DAO and all that. So to here is a domain, right? So to the domain, we also have a basic domain. That means that the core domain, for example, I have a generic document, I have an invoice. This is a standard invoice. But this standard invoice, if can be used in many different industries, let's say, for example, medical industry. So for medical industry, the customer is actually called the patient name. Then if it is saloon industry, it is called maybe the I don't know, the worker is called the beautician. They have a different terminology. If it is food and beverage industry, the person who key in the thing is called the cashier. So they have a different words. Then the nurse, the receptionist, counter, they want to call it whatever. They call it based on the different industry in a different domain. But the domain need to have basic or a document name called sales invoice, internal sales invoice, or something like that. Now, this internal sales invoice in a restaurant, it can be called a cash bill.
Mm-hmm.
In hospital, it's called medical bill. Mm-hmm. So it has got different name in a different domain. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think in this case we need to have different repositories also to maybe each repository is responsible to get data from a different resource.
Yeah, right. Yeah, that's correct. So the repository will need to use different resources and unit of work, or maybe some unit of work must be together, then it will put in one unit of work. But some unit of work, if fail, is okay. I can still have the other unit of work continue. So it can break down. Sometimes each unit of work can consist of 3 to 4 unit, other unit, sub unit of work, and so on. Mm. So it can be just like your Windows Explorer, you can have a folder with files, but inside the folder can have more folders and more files inside the folder, or more folders inside the folders, or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but each unit of work should start the transaction and commit transaction alone.
Each unit.
Although we have nested unit of work. I think in case of nested unit of work, maybe we can.
I think you can do it in such a way that the top level unit of work can have a connection. If it is not the top level unit of work, it needs to share the same connection, because in order for you to isolate the transaction, it require. I mean, to have a full begin and end transaction, it needs to make use of the same connection, I think.
Actually, I have saw three scenarios to implement unit of work, and as you say, we can think of a big unit of work that contains smaller unit of works inside, and the begin and commit transaction should be in the upper level. But I don't recommend this design.
Okay.
If we break the unit of work into smaller unit of works, each unit of work is completed all alone, regardless on who is the caller of this unit of work. I think this is better, because we can ensure the data consistency in each unit of work alone. We don't need to to handle the upper level of unit of work and ensure consistency in each of smaller one. And I think down business unit of work, I think it is better for that type of consistency. Actually, the nested unit of work, maybe if we need a nested operations or nested transactions, maybe we can handle this in repository layer, a higher layer, which is repository. We can handle the flow, how it would proceed from unit of work to another unit of work. In other words, from transaction to another transaction, and the steps of the use case scenario. So I don't recommend, I don't recommend to have nested unit of work.
I see. Okay. Okay, so in each repository, Am I right to say that there could be many unit of work, but each of the unit of work are independent of each other? They are not nested. That means that, understand. It's okay. I think we can start with something like you suggested is fine. Until we hit the scenario, there's no other way to solve them. We see how we solve.
Okay. Then, as I say, the unit of work will handle the aggregate object, which is the grouping of header, line, extensions, and events.
Say again, header, line.
The aggregate class would contain the header class with its lines, extensions, and events.
Oh no! Wait, hold on. I agree with the header and line. For the extension and the event is questionable. I give you an example. Let's say I have one header with 10 lines. One header with 10 lines, but I got let's say 5 extension. But my event is actually being inserted by a different process or different workflow or different something like that. And my extension, actually, let's just say in a big ledger, because we are doing a data lake application, which is a slightly different, whereby I have many different applets. So this is a HR applet. This is a sales applet. This is a sales and marketing applet. That one is a CRM applet or something like that. So let's just say I have a document. So when I have this invoice document, and for the HR applet, it will want to insert certain extension saying that this sales invoice has been paid a commission to the salesman or something. It wants to insert certain extension to this generic document table that another applet don't know, because the sales maybe the other applet don't care about this extension. So when the first applet save this document, maybe it will save this document with a certain extension type code or something like that, that another applet do not care. And the other applet, when it reads this applet, it may load all the extension, or it may load only the extension that are related to the applet. But the header and the line, yes, they load all. But for the extension and the event, maybe there is a possibility that it only loads the one that is relevant to the applet. It may load all, but when there is a chance that in the Angular side, it may not handle all the extension, it may not handle all the event, and it doesn't care anyway.
But I think events and extensions, they relate, they are linked to a header table.
Yes, they are linked to the header table, but it may have its own separate endpoint. That means that when you want to insert just an event into the table that is linked to a specific generic document, you do not need to load the entire document just to insert one event. You can actually just call an API, insert the event into the event table that is attached to this document.
Okay, I see the problem as when we need to insert an event, it means we need to update the header. We need to update the header by its extensions.
Yeah, but this is not necessarily. I give you an example. Let's say I have a header invoice belongs to this branch. The amount is how much? Actually, this one no change. What I'm doing is merely to say that this document has been approved or not approved. But whether this document approved or not approved, the status of the document is still active. The amount of the document is still the same. The item code ABC product of this document is still the same. The customer is still the same. Address is still the same. Everything is still the same. And this event that is being inserted, I just want to append an event. And to append this event, I don't need to keep loading the whole database, searching for this document and all the extension that is related, load it to the web browser and then save it back again. I don't need to do that.
Okay. Okay. Then we don't need to aggregate.
No, you can have the aggregate. You can have the aggregate. That's not a problem. But what I'm just saying is that in the aggregate, you can have extension, you can have event, you can have all that, no problem. But I'm just saying that it is not compulsory. When you create, it's easy, but it becomes very tricky when you edit. Let's say when you edit, and this header has got 10 lines, all good, but it has got, when you load 30 events that comes with this document. And then at the same time, some other events are being inserted by another API, by another client inserted into this document. So when you save, maybe when you load this 30, you add 2, so it becomes 32, but another party add another 5, actually it's total 37. But when you save, when you load this one header, 10 line and 30 events plus 2 that you just added, and then you modify some value, and then after that you save. When you save, you cannot delete the other 5 that is inserted by another process, another client, or another applet, or another user, or something like that. You should not delete other people's one. But when you save, when you load and when you save, you can modify the value if you have the GUID of the role, but you should not actually delete the 5 new event that is inserted by another process because you don't recognize them, you delete them, no. This part is very important because we are building a very highly concurrent system where you have multiple clients accessing the same data at the same time, and very often there is a lot of situation where you have a race condition. That is why we have status, we have the revision, and everywhere in every single database table.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So in this case, you recommend to have a standalone endpoint to handle extensions and events.
Yeah, correct.
Okay. But we still need to have the aggregate, which is aggregate the 4 tables together or the 4 objects together. Maybe for when we need to get, not for edit or delete, or when we need to read data. We need to have this 4 all together.
Okay.
What about the connection between, or the data type between DOM and the repository layer? If we need to have a data transfer object here, DTO.
Hello, I think your internet connection is not stable. You're breaking off.
We have extra rules to against this component star.
Okay. Sorry.
In this case, we can.
Because I lost you for the last about 15 seconds.
Okay. I say that. If we need to have a data transfer object, DTO.
Yes. Okay, DTO.
Layer. This DTO, what it should contain, DTO object. Also, header and lines, extensions and events.
Okay. When you have the DTO object, I would think that ideally, it should mimic the database column and field, so that we can actually make use of a reflection to actually pass the object from the database all the way to the Angular without any problem. And first of all, in the DTO, it should mimic aggregate object. Mm-hmm. Is it aggregate or composite? I got a little bit confused. Let me check. Aggregate versus composite object. Let me see. So
in case of headers and lines, I think aggregate and the extensions, the events.
Okay, so they have a class composition is okay, composition is an example of a person, the head and the hand and the leg.
Mm-hmm.
So but aggregation is like where a child can exist independently of the parent.
I think aggregate design pattern is different from what we say aggregation and composition. In
what we should be using is association.
Yeah, aggregation is a type of association in the end. But I think the aggregate design pattern is different from aggregation.
Okay. Association is the overall, and then association can be split into aggregation and composition. So house and a room, so implies a relationship where a child cannot exist independent of the parents. So what I'm saying is that if I have a class is a child, okay, so ours is aggregation. That means that if I have a generic document aggregation object, then this generic document aggregation object has got one member variable, which is called the header, and then another vector, which is for the line, and then another vector, which is for the extension, another vector or tree map, which is for the event or whatever. So that means that so we should be using the aggregation, right?
Hmm. Okay. Yeah, but the aggregation relation between objects is different from aggregate design pattern. Regardless of how we can relate the header with lines and extension, I mean the aggregate design pattern is a way to make a composition of some components that need to be together from business point of view. This is what I mean by aggregate design pattern. Mm. Regardless of what is the relation between objects, if the relation is aggregation or composition or whatever, the aggregate design pattern is a way to grouping components that needs to be together with the rules that ensure consistency between these components and how these components need to compose to each other. This is the aggregate design pattern as I understand it. So I mean by aggregate design pattern, we need to define a class to contain a header object with a list of line object and a list of extensions object, list of events. This is okay. The aggregate design pattern, and we need in this class to define some rules that on how we can aggregate this header with decisions and whatever. This is the aggregate design pattern.
Yeah, I'm looking at it. So this is a aggregate root that you're talking about, right?
Mm.
There's a So it says the aggregate route is also responsible for ensuring the consistency of the aggregate.
Yeah.
So you're talking about the aggregate route for, let's say, generic document. So there's an aggregate route that actually makes sure that let's just say the document line is saying that I have 10 item in line 1, 20 in line 2, so total should be 30.
Yeah.
So the total amount of the of the header should be 30 ringgit instead of 28 or 20, 32 or something like that. It makes sure the consistency, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is the aggregate design button. What I say is, in aggregate design button, we would have a header object with lines, extensions, and events. Also, in DTO object, we need to have, again, header, lines, extensions, and events. But in DTO, we don't need anything else. We need also only data. Data from business point of view, but in aggregate design button, we grouping the data with rules that ensure the consistency of this data. We maybe in aggregate route, we maybe define some functions on how this data would compose to each other and how this data would related to each other. So I think in this case, the aggregate class would have the same data as DTO class, but with extra things that is the rules on how we can handle this data together. So what do you think in this duplication in data?
There's no duplication now, because when you have an aggregate route, actually, if we separate it clearly, let's say if we consider the header, the line, and all this, it should not contain the logic, it should just store the data. Mm-hmm. So if the data that is stored inside is wrong, it doesn't know by itself. But the aggregate route is the one that actually makes sure that they are consistent when they are being stored.
Mm. Right? And the same aggregate,
aggregate route.
Then the same aggregate object, we consider it as DTO object, and then we use one object between the same object between domain and repository, and the same object between repository and unit of work.
Okay. Okay. If let's say the aggregate rule, it doesn't care about transaction, it only care about making sure that the data are consistent. Mm. So the transaction management inside the unit of work will take care of the try and the catch, and then after that it will roll back if there's an error or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But the aggregate route just make sure that before it saves, the amount total in the header is equal to the sum of the line, and so on.
Okay.
So but the data object, the DTO object,
mm-hmm.
Will have something extra. For example, DTO object need to have pagination. It needs to have limit and offset. It needs to have DTO when you are because in the API endpoint you have a create, update, and delete. So the create and update and delete can action upon a single entity. It's not really a single entity, because when you have aggregate, you actually have a few classes and Some is a vector of entity, some is a single entity, right? So when you create an update and a delete, you have usually have one single header GUID. That means that the main object with a GUID.
Mm-hmm.
However, when you read, sometimes you can read one, but sometimes you can read 10. But supposedly, if you say that I want to get a list of invoices for a certain branch without specifying the date range, for some businesses, it may return millions of records. So it is quite important to actually specify the limit and the offset. I'm going to open this Visual Studio Code, and then I will share with you certain file. Just 1 second. Okay, so if you were to look at the OpenLib, and then there is a just 1 second, I am trying to recall where, because I haven't touched it for some time. Okay, if you look at this offset limit, you also need to have a sort criteria. For example, when I load a list of invoice, yes, I have limit offset, but when the return data is sorted in a random order, I will be getting different data. So the sorting is actually quite important to make sure that every time I call the API, I get the same set of data when I return it based on a certain sort criteria.
Mm-hmm.
And then, and if let's say when I return the sort criteria, I don't say what criteria, then by default, there must be minimum one default sort criteria by GUID that will still return you a consistent set of sequence when it returns you the data when you put a limit and an offset. So this sort criteria is quite important, and this sort criteria is different from the conditional criteria.
Mm-hmm.
So when you have this pagination object being embedded into the DTO, and even for the DTO, don't forget you also may need to have a, I don't know, this one is version number. I think maybe this one is already in the database table, because over time, we may have a lot of old data. And as you know that some of our database tables are having a JSON column. So some of these JSON column, the format, the fields, the way we store the data, the variables in the JSON may change over time. So when we load this data and trying to read them, it may change. So we need to actually map it back to the correct object version.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's tricky, right? Complicated.
Mm.
Yeah, so if you look at this base template service model, no, this is not this pagination model. You can look at the, I don't know how many minutes is now, but yeah, I think you can scroll to this section to look at this pagination model. So the DTO, when we store all this pagination model, it is actually not important when it comes to the aggregate object, when it is primarily focusing on I think the DTO is mainly primarily being used at the between the API and the Angular.
Mm-hmm.
I think so. Of course, when the Angular call the API through the controller, it takes this DTO. It can pass this DTO. It can go through the domain layer where mm-hmm. it try to understand, oh, this one is a medical industry. This one is a what industry? It try to identify which domain it should belongs to. So it does whatever that is specific to that domain. And then after it does what it needs to the domain, processing, filter ready, then it will call the repository. So when you call the repository, you can pass this object to the repository, no problem. Because maybe the domain, if I'm operating a hospital, maybe hospital is exempted from SST. There's no tax for the government because it's hospital. But if it is a school, it's free. But if it is a private industry, then I actually the same invoice because it is a retail industry. So because it's a retail industry, I actually need to make sure that I save into certain multiple repository, or I go into a repository. Maybe I have one repository for the tax. I have one repository for just saving the invoice. So for the saving of the invoice, regardless of what industry, whether it's medical or retail, you still need to save the invoice. But for the tax, it will only be activated if this is a different industry. So the business logic of whether the SST should be safe, the tax, GST, SST should be safe or not, or something like that, can be decided at the domain layer. Mm-hmm. But at the from the repository down to the unit of work, usually it should handle lower level logic that just ensure the integrity of the data. For example, if I am having a foreign key pointing to another table, and this foreign key is not enforced in the database, so there's no constraint in the database, but I need to make sure that if you are foreign key pointing to another table, the table is correct. Is there such table and there's such a GUID to allow you to save, ensure the basic stuff that is low level. But if you have things like a GST, SST must be safe, don't need to be safe, or maybe ensuring that the item code, let's say, for example, I create a sales order. If you're looking at computer industry, if you create a sales order or a cash bill, your item code must refer to an item which must be valid. But if you are doing an accounting software for services industry, sometimes they just want to type the description first without actually putting the item code. So your generic document line, actually the item code is supposed to be foreign key to another item table, but it is not. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. Yet we can still allow the people to save as draft. You can save as draft, but you cannot confirm the invoice because you haven't put in the item code. But there is no such rules in government saying that you must have an item code. Nobody say you must have an item code if you want to create an invoice. If you see some invoice, they just give you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 with what is the description and the amount. They don't show you the item code.
Mm.
Right? Not everybody say that item code is compulsory. So when it comes to the ERP industry, I know that you're a programmer, you're not an accountant or something like that. So I need to give you feedback on what are the possible scenarios.
Mm. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Then we need to differentiate between DTO layer, DTO object, and the aggregate object.
Yeah.
Okay. Even if the data maybe it be duplicated, but there is extra things in DTO not exist in aggregate, and maybe vice versa. Maybe in aggregate we have extra rules, but in DTO we don't have. Right?
But having said that, I also want you to avoid doing what I think in the core one we are currently doing, whereby the same object, we do a lot of work, copy the value to another object, then we just copy it again, just copy one more time. So from the API all the way to the database, the same thing, we just do nothing much, just copy, create another object, copy the value one more time, and then save it. So that is something that I try to avoid. Copy for the sake of copying. But if you were to understand each of the layer, actually it is performing different function with a different purpose, then some part of it you can actually pass through the object. You can pass directly from a DTO all the way to the database, is fine for me, but you need to make sure that, you see, there are some ways of doing it. One is that you create one object, one class. Every time you do something, you need to copy the value and then into this object, then this class pass to another object, you need to copy one more time. That's one way of doing it. The other way of doing it is I have one object that go through the conveyor belt. So each time it goes through the conveyor belt, I have a machine. Okay, here I put some pepper, here I put some salt, here I put some tomato sauce. Then at the end of the day, I get something back to the database. So that way, I'm treating the object that passed through without copying. But I add something, check something in the process. So it's like a production line. Actually, to a certain stage, I need to split into two. Split. Let's say you come here. Okay, I split because. When you want to create when you create an invoice and it has got a membership point, so not only I need to save the invoice, save the member point, I need to deduct the inventory, I need to update the journal transaction or something like that, I need to do a few other things because of the creation of the invoice. Maybe creation of an invoice, to some people, some business, they say that no, when I create the invoice, I want to create it as a draft. I didn't say that when I create the invoice, you need to deduct my stock immediately, because after I create the invoice, I need to let the manager to check first, and then the customer will click a confirmation. Then only I will issue the invoice. But you don't, even though I've issued the invoice, but you don't deduct the stock, because when you deduct the stock, it will give me a problem, because sometimes I may want to decide to take the stock from this warehouse. Sometimes I want to take from that warehouse. So when it comes to business processes, sometimes it can be tricky, because there could be many different scenario and situations and the workflow. Many of the software companies, what they do is that they hard code, just like how we did in our first ERP system. So when we hard code it, okay, fine, it's easy to develop, but at the same time, we limit ourselves in a situation whereby we cannot do certain things. Now, the best and the correct way is actually to make use of a proper workflow system, but I don't want to confuse you with too many things. Now I study domain-driven design, also many database table and permissions and all this, I think you'll be fainted. So what I suggest is that we do the microservices part correctly, save it correctly. Then for the workflow part, what we can do next is that one later, maybe half a year later. We will make it such that just like our Jira issue, whereby every user can actually configure different issue type to make use of different workflow system. So that part later. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah, okay. Okay. I understand. Okay. We can use the same data, but in each level, we can handle it by a different handler. We can the same data object in DTO in domain layer, we can handle it by we can handle it from business point of view, but the same object in aggregate layer, we can handle it by aggregate rule. So in case, as you say, the same object comes through all layers, but in each layers it is handled in a different way. In this case, well, yeah, we can avoid the
issue. The copying.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. I will try to make. I am now trying to implement all what I said, all these design patterns. Also, I discussed every day with Daim, and I told him where I am and what I am doing. So he's aware of what I am working on. I will implement a full example from low level layer to high level layer, and maybe have another discussion with you and with Time maybe. Then we can consider if everything is okay. We consider this is the first seed of Core 2. I hope
Okay. Trust me, you're going to be very proud, because just like some of our other programmers in EMP, the software is being used by so many users all over the country, the biggest computer chain store and all that stuff. So the big ledger will be even bigger, because as you know, did you see the post that I sent to the Telegram group on one of our big customer winning the award and all that stuff? They are the Malaysia best already. We are working with the best already. So there's no other best already. And we are taking the whole data lake platform. What else do you want? So you'll be very proud what someday that when it's used by the whole country, you know? So I think we end today's discussion. Thank you for your time. What I'll do is I'll post this video to the YouTube so that Time also can watch when he's free.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.